Secretaries and friends of chamber, I welcome you all on this day for an important seminar on opportunities in real estate and infrastructure in India. I have been asked to speak something about this seminar, but first of all, we have concluded visit to this NJ complex, and I take this opportunity to congratulate the founders of this enterprise. Really, it's a moment of proudness for Surat that such an enterprising people are existing here. They have created a vast kingdom. It's unimaginable. We have not seen such a corporate office in Surat. So I congratulate them again for that. Friends, as all of you know, Surat is the fastest growing city in India according to the recent survey. And also it's the financial capital of Surat. And we Suratis, there's a large community in Surat who believe in investing in various fields like gold, commodities, share bazaar, etc. And also in the sector of real estate and infrastructure. Hence friends, this seminar will act as an, it will guide you to educate, to will provide with opportunities how to invest your money in various parts of the country in real estate sector by with association with NJ. As all of you know, real estate sector is a lucrative sector for investment. It has highest returns compared to all other sectors. Hence, now it's an opportunity for Suratis to look beyond Surat for investment in real sector, and NJ will act as a catalyst in this direction. They will provide you the opportunity to invest your money in various real estate projects, not only in cities of Gujarat, but across India. Hence friends, it's a golden opportunity, and Southern Gujarat Chamber of Commerce and Industry and NJ have made this effort to guide you on opportunities in real estate sector in India. Now, I invite our 70 years old young friend and always smiling, who always smiles and keeps others also smiling, and our one friend, Mr. Suresh Pachikar, to please come introduce our today's eminent speaker.
Mitra, Jai Sri Krishna. હું તદ્દન જાગૃતપણે સભાન છું કે તમે મને નથી સાંભળવા આવ્યા, પણ છતાં એક કેટલીક ફોર્માલિટીઝ એવી છે કે આપણે પૂરી કરવી પડે. અત્યારે મારી પરિસ્થિતિ, અમે એક કુરિયાત સદા મંગલમ નામની એક્ટિવિટી ચલાવીએ છીએ મેચ મેકિંગની. એમાં કન્યા પક્ષ અને વર પક્ષ બેનું એ હોય છે. હવે જ્યારે લગ્નનો પ્રસંગ આવે ત્યારે અમારી પરિસ્થિતિ એવી હોય છે કે અમે બંને પક્ષ તરફથી હોય છે. આજે પણ કંઈક એવી જ પરિસ્થિતિ છે કે આઈ બિલોંગ ટુ એનજી ઓલ્સો, આઈ બિલોંગ ટુ ચેમ્બર ઓલ્સો. પણ મને આશ્વાસન એક જ છે કે નીરજભાઈ પણ મારી માફક જ છે કે એ પણ આપણા મેનેજિંગ કમિટીના મેમ્બર છે અને એનજીના ફાઉન્ડર જિગ્નેશભાઈ સાથે છે. આ બેને જોઈને મને હંમેશા પેલું શોલે પિક્ચરના જય અને વીરુ યાદ આવે કે એ લોકોનું જે કોમ્બિનેશન છે 1994થી આણંદ વિદ્યાનગરમાં રૂમમેટ હતા ત્યારથી એ લોકો જે સાથે છે, અને જે 16 કે 17 વર્ષમાં અહીં જે પ્રોગ્રેસ થયો છે ને, એને માટે દરેક સુરતી આપણે એનું ગર્વ અને ગૌરવ બે લઈ શકીએ. NJA investment, I consider myself very fortunate to be associated with NJA. કેટલાક એના કારણો છે, નહીં કે બીજા કઈ વિકલ્પો નતા, પરંતુ NJA જોડાવાથી જે આખો એ થઈ ગયો છે. સાહેબ, આઈ એમ હેવિંગ વન મેન શો અને આઈ નીડ નોટ કીપ એની પેપર ઇન માય ઓફિસ. તમે આખી ઓફિસ જોઈ હશે અને જે કંઈક અહીં થાય છે તેનું ફીડબેક અને એનો લાભ અમને મળે છે કે અમારા કોઈ પણ ક્લાયન્ટને કોઈ પણ સર્વિસીસ જોઈતી હોય તો અમે તરત આપી શકીએ છીએ. એક બીજી વાત આંખે ઉડીને વળગે એવી એ છે કે મ્યુચ્યુઅલ ફંડનો બિઝનેસ કરવા માટે હવે એક્ઝામ પણ આપવી પડે છે એમફીલની. કોઈ પણ માણસ મ્યુચ્યુઅલ ફંડનો બિઝનેસ એમને નથી કરી શકતા. ઇન્ડિયામાં 75,000 લગભગ એમફી એટલે એમફી ક્લિયર કરેલા મ્યુચ્યુઅલ ફંડના એડવાઇઝર્સ છે, અને બહુ ગર્વ સાથે આપણે કહી શકીએ કે એમાંના 14,000 એક્ટિવ મેમ્બર્સ એનજેના છે. આજે એનજેની 104 સિટીઝમાં બ્રાન્ચ છે અને 105 અને 106 ના દેર ગોઈંગ ઓફશોર ઓલ્સો. આવા ડાયનેમિક એન્જે ઇન્વેસ્ટમેન્ટમાં વિચારીએ તો આજને દિવસમાં એનું એયુએમ જે એસેટ્સ અંડર મેનેજમેન્ટ કહેવાય છે તે 11,000 કરોડ રૂપિયાનું છે, વિચ ઇઝ વિથ ધ ફિગર સ્પીક્સ ઇટસેલ્ફ કે કેટલી એ એએમસી કંપનીનું એટલું એયુએમ નથી હતું એટલું એન્જેનું છે. આ બધી એક બહુ ગર્વ લેવા જેવી વાત છે, અને વી આર ફોર્ચ્યુનેટ ઇનફ ધેટ વી આર વન્સ મોર લગભગ 2 કે 3 વર્ષ પહેલાં આપણે અહીં આવેલા, પરંતુ વિચાર્યું એમ કે મેનેજિંગ કમિટીના ઘણા નવા મેમ્બર્સો છે અને એ લોકો પણ આનો લાભ લઈ શકે. આટલી સરસ ઓફિસ, ઇટ ઇઝ અ બેસ્ટ હાઈટેક ઓફિસ ઇન સાઉથ ગુજરાત ઇન્ક્લુડિંગ ઓલ કોર્પોરેટ સેક્ટર્સ. અને એક બીજી વાત તમને કહું, વિચ ઇઝ ઓલ્સો વેરી ટ્રુ, કે આઈ એમ એસોસિએટેડ વિથ અધર કંપનીઝ ઓલ્સો કોર્પોરેટ. ઇન્ડિયાની સૌથી બિગેસ્ટ 1964માં આઈબીએમનું સૌથી મોટું 1 રૂમ જેટલું કોમ્પ્યુટર બોમ્બેમાં પહેલાં એક કંપનીમાં આવેલું, અને એને આજે લગભગ 47 વર્ષ થયા છે. પણ સાહેબ મને કહેવા દો કે 64 થી શરૂ કરેલું ને આજે 2011માં એનજે ઇઝ ફાર અહેડ ધેન ધેટ કોર્પોરેટ બોડી ઇન ઇન્ડિયા, જેના કેટલી બ્રાન્ચો અને કેટલો મોટો વિશાળ બિઝનેસ છે. છતાંય એઝ ફાર એઝ આઈટી ઇઝ કન્સર્ન અને સોફ્ટવેર અને જે અમને બીજી બધી ફેસિલિટીઝ આપે ને એમાં એનજે ઇઝ પ્રોબેબલી નંબર 1 ઇન ઇન્ડિયા. વન મોર થિંગ દેટ નાવ એનજે ગ્લોબલ ઇન્વેસ્ટ કંપની દે સ્ટાર્ટેડ ફોર ઓફશોર ઇન્વેસ્ટમેન્ટ ઓલ્સો, એન્ડ વી આર કમિંગ વિથ વેરી ન્યૂ આઈડિયાઝ. એમજે બહુ રાઇટલી 2008-09માં વિચાર્યું કે નાઉ ધ ડાયવર્સિફિકેશન ઇઝ નેસેસરી, એટલે એ લોકોએ મ્યુચ્યુઅલ ફંડ સાથે ઇન્સ્યોરન્સ, રિયલ એસ્ટેટ, પોર્ટફોલિયો મેનેજમેન્ટ સર્વિસીસ ઇન ઇક્વિટી એન્ડ મ્યુચ્યુઅલ ફંડ, આ બધું જ શરૂ કર્યું છે. એક જ હેતુ હતો કે ક્લાયન્ટ્સને વન વિન્ડો બધું જ મળી રહે, અને બીજું એ કે ઓલ ક્લાયન્ટ શુડ બી સેટિસ્ફાઈડ હેવિંગ ધ બેસ્ટ સર્વિસીસ. જિગ્નેશભાઈ, આપણો કાર્યક્રમમાં થોડો ફેરફાર એટલા માટે થયો છે કે આપણા પ્રેસિડેન્ટ ત્યાં ચેમ્બરમાં એક અગત્યની મિટિંગમાં બિઝી છે. ફર્સ્ટ વી આર કન્ડક્ટિંગ ધ સેમિનાર નાવ. જિગ્નેશભાઈ વિલ એડ્રેસ ટુ યુ. થેન્ક યુ વેરી મચ સર.
નાવ આઈ ઇન્વાઇટ જોઈન્ટ મેનેજિંગ ડાયરેક્ટર ઓફ એમજે ઇન્ડિયા ઇન્વેસ્ટ લિમિટેડ શ્રી જિગ્નેશભાઈ દેસાઈ ટુ ડિલિવર હિઝ એડ્રેસ.
We are able to understand the change which is going to happen in next probably 10 to 20 years, then probably you can devise your business accordingly. So first we will talk about what is happening at a global level in terms of the urbanization and how city is performing. Just to give you an idea about the world top 600 cities contribute close to around 60 to 75% of the world GDP. Some of the estimates are at about 70-75, but if we take a very very conservative estimate from the McKinsey, so that comes to around 60%. So if we take the 2007 number in terms of the population, the 1.5 billion, that is about 22% of the global population is from the top 600 cities, and in 2025 is estimated close to around 2 billion, that is about 25% of the global population will be in the top 600 cities of the world. In terms of the GDP, in 2007 the 30 trillion US was the GDP from the top 600 cities, and the estimated GDP by 2025 is about 64 trillion US. So if we look at the urban landscape is quite stable throughout the journey, but I think the major change is the top 600 city will not be the same tomorrow. I think that is the change, and that is the big opportunity for all of us. That is the big opportunity for all developing economy, because one in every third city of developed economy will be out of the game. So their ability to generate and to contribute GDP will be much lesser than the cities which are coming from the developing cities. So there will be an addition of close to around 136 cities by 2025 in the top list of 600 cities, which conservatively will going to contribute about 60% of the global GDP. And the major reason for this is industrialization. Wherever there is a growth in the industry will generate the employment, and that employment leads to create a new city. If we look at in out of this 136 cities, I think the major contribution will come from China and India. So last month I was reading one of the report that China is claiming about 100 odd cities by 2025, and probably the balance is with us and other small countries which are yet to develop. So I think this is the broad idea about in next couple of years the growth will come from this new city, and the challenge for all of us is how to make it happen. So we'll just if you look at the India urbanization trend, and this is also one of the report that India will overtake China by 2030 in terms of the net urban population. and by 2030 the GDP will increase by about 5 times. The city with more than 1 million population to increase from 42 city to about 68 city, and the urban household will increase from 22 million to 91 million. So about 590 million people will live in city. So that is the kind of growth will happen. And if you look at even in the earlier slide, there is a stability in urbanization is there. But if you look at from city to city, there might be a huge change in terms of the growth of the urbanization, which will going to happen in probably next 1 or 2 decades. The 70% of the new employment will be generated in this city, contributing more than about 70% of the India GDP. So increasing trend of emergence of the new city based on the urban planning and industrialization trend. So I think this is the most important thing that in terms of understanding of the urbanization and industrialization trend today, so then probably you will be able to forecast the future cities of our country. So what we have done today, we have taken one example of the new development which will going to come in our country, and I think this is probably the largest initiative of its kind in the world, which is a DMIC, the Delhi Mumbai Industrial Corridor. It's about 1483 kilometer long corridor, and 150 kilometer both the sides will be the part of the DMIC development. And the plan is every 50 kilometers there will be a industrial hub backed by the social infrastructure and backed by the residential infrastructure. I think this will going to change the India in next probably 20 to 30 years. So I'll run through one small AV, so will give us a broad idea.
For instance, the spotlight is on the corridor of possibilities and how a track connecting India's political capital, New Delhi, and commercial capital, Mumbai, can make such a world of difference.
A dedicated freight corridor is being built between Dadri in the National Capital Region to JN Port Trust in Mumbai. This high-speed rail corridor would cover a distance of 1,483 kilometers and would pass through 6 states. And that is not all. A mega industrial corridor would be created along the freight network. This corridor would have 9 industrial zones and is expected to give an immense boost to the economy. The Delhi-Mumbai Industrial Corridor, as it is christened, was first conceived in 2006 when India signed an MOU with Japan for this project. The DMIC is expected to cost $100 billion and Japan would pitch in with $10 billion. This is perhaps the largest infrastructure project conceived in the country since independence, and the responsibility of pulling this huge task rests on the shoulder of one man, Amitabh Kant. Kant is the man behind the Incredible India campaign, which completely turned around the fortunes of the tourism industry of the country. And his resume is so strong that he was handpicked by the government to lead this project.
It's very important for India to grow at 9 to 10% for a very long period, on a very sustained basis, for a period of next 3 decades. The logistic costs in these countries is substantially lower than India. In India, it's as high as about 12.5% of your GDP as compared to about 6-6.5% in Japan. There's a dedicated freight corridor project which links up Delhi to Mumbai, which is a container train which will only carry containers. When you do a new container train, it provides an opportunity for you to create new manufacturing cities. It provides an opportunity for you to do new urbanization.
Most all of us are familiar with scenes like this, Cities like Delhi and Mumbai are bursting at their seams, and things are only going to get worse from here on. Over the next two decades, more than 350 million people would move from villages to cities. And imagine what would be the situation then. And that is why the Delhi-Mumbai Industrial Corridor assumes such an importance. 24 new cities would be developed around the corridor, and the first 7 of them would come into existence by 2018. As Kant says, that this would be the first time since the development of Chandigarh that cities would be built from scratch.
India is starting this process of urbanization very late. We should have done this right after Chandigarh. But we're doing about 40 years late. And if you're doing it 40 years late, the important thing for India is to use new technology to make a quantum jump.
DMIC would also ensure that none of these cities face the same problems as the existing metros. Taking a cue from China and Japan, the cities would have their own water recycling plant so as to reduce their water consumption. Emphasis would be laid on creating a strong public transport system, and a mixed land use will ensure that most people would be able to walk or cycle to their offices. The cities would have underground utility corridors for parking, sewage disposal and communication lines so as to give the city a clean look.
The Delhi-Mumbai Industrial Corridor is perhaps the first step in the right direction. This project would not only boost industrial output but would also pave the way for rapid urbanization.
This is about the development which will going to happen in our country. And I think if you look at the vision of the DMIC, I think the key focus area is on employment, industrial output and the exports. And there are many institutions who works on the projections locally and globally. But if we take the average of those, I think the projected industrial CAGR is about 13% for the next decade, I think, which is a very, very big number. And the growth output is about 14 times. I think these are the two main area where probably the entire machinery is working towards. And this is the objective and goal to achieve by way of, Mr. Kant says, that I think the major challenge for all of us is to reduce the logistic cost. And I think that is the highest in the world as of now compared to other developing as well as the developed economy. So I think with this development, I think probably the major logistic cost will definitely going to reduce. And at the time of planning of this particular corridor, they have taken many geographical issues into the consideration in terms of the high tide seas, the gas network, oil network, oil fields and all. So I'll give you some of the example going forward. But I think this is where the challenge lies, and the opportunity is also there. How to capture this opportunity is again a big subject. But it's not only restricted to the real estate sector, but I think is across the all industries. Just to, Japan is our technical advisor for this DMIC development, and I think as Mr. Kant said, that the basic objective is we are late and we need technology to cover up that particular time. And based on the research, I think Japanese companies have an ability to build new tracks. They have an ability to build new city in a record time. So that was the main purpose to collaborate with Japan and to take their advice in terms of mainly it's not a financial collaboration, it's more of a technical collaboration. and we can definitely. So I think in 1964 they have created one this kind of a industrial corridor. It was about 550 kilometers. Today is about more than 1900 to 2000 kilometers, and it was mainly connected to the Tokyo, Osaka, and Nagoya. I think it's a classic example of think ahead, and we have visited even this corridor, and today it's a real industrial. And if you look at there are a couple of images available of 1964. And if you look at those images and the current development, is an amazing development. So, if we specifically talk about the DMIC, it's about 1483 kilometers from. Oh my. Hello. It's about 1483 kilometers, and passes through six states, which is UP, NCR of Delhi, Haryana, Rajasthan, Gujarat, and Maharashtra, from Jain Port to Dadri. And if you look at the Gujarat, I think that's the interesting number for all of us, is about 565 kilometers, which is about 38%. So we are extremely lucky that we are in Gujarat at the right time. And currently, the major cities in DMIC, which is more than 1 million, the 10 cities are Delhi, Bombay, Faridabad, Meerut, Jaipur, Ahmedabad, Surat, Vadodara, Pune, and Nasik. So these are the existing 10 cities. Which will definitely going to benefit, and which will definitely going to grow. And the existing six cities, which are in the range of half a million to 1 million, is Ghaziabad. And I think this is a very interesting city, Bhavnagar, because Bhavnagar is, if you look at geographically, is very far off. And it's a part of Saurashtra, but I think there are so many small developments which are going on under the DMIC policies, which are left to the state government. And one of the development is the Kalpasar, which is a Kalpasar from Dahesh to Bhavnagar. It's about 40 nautical miles. So they are going to build a water reservoir, and top of the water reservoir, there will be a road which connects Dahesh to the Bhavnagar. So you can reach from Bharuch to Bhavnagar in about 20-25 minutes. So because of that perspective, Bhavnagar is there in it's very important city due to. So the idea out here is, if we go back to the earlier slide, that we need to contribute cities in the world of 600 cities. I think this DMIC development will going to help us to accommodate the urban population and probably to create new city, which will be part of the top list of the world. And if we take straight wise, so in terms of development in UP, there will be a two nodes, and the alignment is close to around 20-25 kilometers. In Haryana, it's about four nodes, and the alignment is again the same. And the Haryana region is covering about 60% of the. In the Rajasthan, Rajasthan is a long alignment, is about 578 kilometers. And there are about five nodes, and strategically also the government is, the Rajasthan government is also very focused on this development, and some part of the Rajasthan is very close to the NCR, which is close to the Bhiwadi. And I think that particular area, the development is already started. The couple of industrial zones are already operational, and output is already there. The employment generation is there, and you can see a huge real estate jump in the sector of Bhiwadi. In Maharashtra, we all know that the major development is going to happen in Dighi. So Dighi port is one of the big asset for Maharashtra to capture the industrial growth. And then these are the four, and I think in Igatpuri, Nasik, Sinnar region, the development, welcome sir. In the Nasik, Igatpuri Sinnar region, the development is already started. A couple of SEZ, the private SEZ, one of the SEZ is the India Pools SEZ, which is already operational. So there are a couple of pockets even in Maharashtra which are doing extremely well. MP is about 4 knots, and in MP, this Ratlam Nagda, which is a node number 23, currently the developments are extremely good, and a couple of industries, the auto ancillaries and all, which is already started there. Now I think we'll more focus on Gujarat, and we'll spend more time on Gujarat because it's very interesting for all of us, and luckily we have a major share out of it, so 565 kilometers. So there will be five main region: Ahmedabad, Dholera, Vadodara, Ankleshwar, Bharuch, Dahej, Surat, Navsari, and Umargaon industrial area. So out of this five, we'll focus on two, and so we'll come to know what kind of development going on even at a state level, and what kind of opportunity we'll be able to get out of it. So Gujarat, we all know that GSDP growth is more than 10% in last maybe about 15 years or so. Population is 51 million. Urbanization is about 37.4, which is expected to around 50 to 53% in next 7 to 8 years. 22% of the Indian exports is from Gujarat. The industrial growth projected is about, we have achieved industrial growth by 2004 to 2008 is about 13%. So the future growth is also in line with the growth which we have achieved in the past, and highest number of investment proposals currently. So also one AV on Gujarat, what's going on there.
Across Gujarat about the Delhi-Mumbai industrial corridor. Almost 40% of the entire stretch of the corridor would pass through the state, and the state government is planning big to cash in on this opportunity.
We will have new ports, you will have new international kind of airports, you will have 6 or 8 lane highways, you will have smart townships, you will have logistic chain, cold storages to cargo handling facilities. You will have maybe the air cargo and maintenance facilities for the airships and kind of things. So this is going to be a tremendous opportunity with a huge multiplier effect.
The government has earmarked 13 zones as SIRs or special investment regions around the corridor for development. And the range of industries in these hubs would range from auto manufacturers to logistics majors. And experts are quick to point out that DMIC would usher in a new wave of growth in Gujarat.
Almost the entire hinterland
is going to use this corridor for all the requirements of imports and exports. With the 40% footprint of Gujarat's ports that exist today for the northern part of landlocked states in the state, in the country, the impact of this is going to be in three folds. One is the logistics part of it. The other thing is that they're going to be a logistics hub somewhere along the corridor. And the ports of Gujarat is going to be the third biggest beneficiary for this entire, from this entire exercise.
Gujarat is indeed speeding on the highway to success, and the Delhi-Mumbai Industrial Corridor would play a major role in sustaining the growth momentum.
So, if you look at the master plan of Gujarat, it's split into three parts. One is the industrial estate. There is about 202 industrial estate which are typically a GIDC. So this Navsari GIDC, Sachin GIDC, these are all part of the industrial estate. So in terms of industrial estate, we have a couple of old existing industrial estate, and government has identified a couple of areas where they are going to set up a new industrial estate as well. Like Vilayat is one of the new GIDC which is coming up close to the Hedge. It's in the Wagra district. So there are a couple of others GIDC which will come in next probably 5 to 7 years, and there will be industrial investment regions and the SEZ. So in terms of the SEZ, the current plan is about 60 odd SEZ. Now if we talk about SEZ and special investment region, so 60 SEZ and 13 investment regions. So there are different stages of development. One is to identify the land, second conceptualization, appointment of a consultant, get a conceptualized drawing, and then to prepare a DP, after that DP, TP, acquisition methodology, then acquisition, and then actual allotment will take place. After allotment, operational, and the output, employment, and addition to the GDP. So this is the entire process. So if we talk about 60 SEZ and the 13 SIR, the currently out of 13 SIR, the master plan is ready for about four of the SIR. The identification of spot is already been done, earmarking is already been done, land acquisition is already been completed in about four SIR. There are different methodology to acquire land, so we'll not get into all that, but there are, if you look at Dahej, there is a different methodology to acquire land. For Dholera, there is a different methodology to acquire land. So the progress is on of all the 13 SIR and similarly with the SEZ. Now, if we talk about Dahej, so we have identified two main spot for Gujarat. One is the Dahej and second is Dholera. So Dahej is about 453 square kilometer in terms of the area. So 45,300 odd hectare. So this land is already been acquired by the government from about 44 villages surrounding to the Dahej, Wagra, Kadodra, Takal and the Bharuj area. So GIDC is acting as a master developer, and this SEZ is about 1700 hectare SEZ. It's a part of the entire development. And the SEZ alone will attract close to around 30,000 plus investment. And the SEZ is currently operational. So if you go there and visit, so you can see there are about 1 lakh people working close to the Dahej, and there is no housing facility as of now in the Dahej. So the nearest housing facility is at 45 kilometers, which is at Bharuj. So these are the proposed components, area of focus, the master plan zone which they have developed for about 425 odd square kilometers, and the one of the zone they have kept for the housing as well as the integrated township. And the objective of to create a zone for the housing is to absorb the labor force of the industries which are already been there. So their policy is once they allot an industrial unit, industrial plot to any industry, they allot 10% of that particular area for the housing facilities also, and targeting mainly for the labor force. So these are the main focus area. And based on this only they have created a master plan, zoning, and allotment is also already been started. This Dholera is again a very interesting story, and the land acquisition difference between Dahej and Dholera, the in Dahej, from the 44 villages they have acquired is 400 odd square kilometer land from the farmer at the average rate of about 10 lakhs rupees per acre. But the Dholera is like Surat. You have agriculture land, and if it is a part of SIR, then there is a concept of TP. So in Dholera they are going to take 50%, so the balance 50% is remaining with you. And I think they have already declared TP1 and TP2 as per the schedule. So Dholera again is a very interesting city. We have one small clip, so we'll show you that.
Gujarat has always thought ahead of its times. Once again, it is going to create history. It is going to create the Special Investment Regions, or the SIRs, that will reshape India's industrial and economic base. It is going to set up the Dholera Special Investment Region. This very first SIR showcases the global vision and the big dream of Gujarat's Chief Minister, Sri Narendra Modi. The Dholera SIR is going to be developed in an area of more than 360 square kilometers. It will be developed as a global hub of economic activity, supported by world-class infrastructure, premium civic amenities, and centers of excellence. It will cater to both international and domestic markets. The SIR will have multiple business, financial, recreational, and residential districts. It will provide the next generation of housing with cultural, recreational, and amusement spaces. The centerpiece of the SIR is the CBD, the Central Business District. This building will be a masterpiece of design and art, an iconic structure that will stand out as an imprint of Gujarat's ingenuity and enterprising spirit, a true monument dedicated to New Gujarat, the Golden Gujarat. The Dholera SIR will have a low carbon footprint due to extensive investments in harnessing solar and wind power. The adjoining Kalpasar Dam will create a sweet water reservoir which will transform the area into a lush green landscape. And on the outskirts, it is proposed to further develop the Black Buck Sanctuary and the golf course as tourist attractions. The central spine of the Dholera SIR will be a 10-lane expressway. This will connect the SIR with Ahmedabad on the one hand and with the airport and seaports on the other. The SIR will also be linked with Ahmedabad City through a metro rail system. The SIR will be serviced by a world-class international airport and major seaports in the area. While the state government is committed to public investment in core infrastructure, it is also open to attracting private investments. The SIR will be governed by a new SIR Act, another first of its kind in India. The state government has already enacted the SIR Act. SIR is a self-governed economic region enjoying global benchmarks. It has the full support of the central government and the commitment of the state government and its leadership. It has the logistics support of the upcoming Dedicated Freight Corridor, or DFC, between Delhi and Mumbai. The SIR will be serviced by the Gujarat International Finance Tech City, which is better known as GIFT. The Tolera SIR is a lifetime opportunity. The SIR offers a gamut of opportunities. Opportunities that exist in building its infrastructure. Opportunities that exist in setting up industries or other economic activities. Opportunities that exist in building landmark buildings. Buildings that will be remembered by generations to come. Be in the SIR. Make it your workplace. Make it your home. Being in the SIR makes strong business sense.
Gujarat can. And Gujarat will.
The vision of the leadership is clear. The Tolera SIR is going to be a global reality much before you foresee. The state government has already commenced work on the central spine of the SIR. It has allocated 26,000 hectares of land for the SIR, in addition to allocating 1,700 hectares of land for the International Airport, located near the SIR. And anchor tenants are already in place. Being in the SIR is being ahead of the times. Invest in Tolera SIR. Invest in your future.
Tolera SIR. New Gujarat, begin.
So this is all about Tolera. The central spine work is, if you go there, it's already started. And this is the world's biggest SIR. The total area is about 900 square kilometer, and out of that, about 28% land is for the agriculture, 13 is for residential, and 19 is for industries. So the core industrial development will take place in the area of close to around 326 kilometers. So if you just look at the total scale, the 900 square kilometer, today the Singapore is about 628 kilometers. So this is the kind of scale which currently we are talking about. So so the Ahmedabad Tolera Bhavnagar 6 land, so which is a center spine, and there they are planning to have about 10 lane road, which we have seen in the movie as well. So it's an integrated mega industrial park, and the proposed development is about the shipyard, the SEZ, and they are going to give some allotments to the even private SEZ also. So I think that policy will shortly they are planning to frame up, and there will be a private SEZ also, the part of the Tolera, and there will be an independent private power plants. So it will be I think Adani, and there are a couple of other players, they have already started bidding for the power plants and all, and development of the logistic hub at Surendra Nagar, which is also part of the Saurashtra region. So that's all. Thanks for your time, and the opportunities are unlimited for all of us, and it's not only restricted to real estate, but all the sectors. Now how to capture these opportunities, it's up to you, and we as NJ are committed in whichever manner you want, and we are working hard on these new developments which are going to take place in next probably 2 or 3 decades, and to capture the maximum growth out of it. Thanks a lot. ये जो ओवरऑल जो टाइमलाइन है इफ वी लुक एट फ्रॉम द टॉप तो द टारगेट फर्स्ट टारगेट जो है वो 2018 का है तो 2018 तक एक प्लान है कि इतना ऑपरेशनल होना चाहिए एंड देन प्रोबेबली स्टेप बाय स्टेप करना पड़ेगा बिकॉज इफ यू लुक एट द ग्लोबल एक्सपीरियंस कोई भी सिटी को बिल्ट होने में इट टेक्स अबाउट 40 to 50 ईयर्स उसको ब्रेक इवन होने में 15 साल लगता है एंड वी आर टॉकिंग अबाउट दिस काइंड ऑफ अ सिटी सो टू रियली फिगर आउट सो द आंसर टू योर क्वेश्चन इज वी हैव डेडलाइन फॉर द फेजेस नॉट फॉर द एंटायर थिंग्स टू हैपन बट इट मे टेक अबाउट fully operational yeah like Singapore and all may take about 30 to 40 years that's the rough idea but the phase wise development will definitely will start so if you link with the 2025 top 600 cities Dholera we wish that it's a part of that and may you know deliver results Actually, the today's objective is to, you know, not to do any business, but in terms of investments, currently we on the real estate side we market the projects. So we started in 2007 and we thought real estate is a very highly unorganized sector and top of that this is one of the largest industry and there is no regulator so that is the sad part for our country so we thought there is a huge scope to add value for the ethical organization like us to you know help out consumer to buy their homes because again housing is going to be the biggest challenge for next one or two decades and so we started with tying up with the developers those who are committed and the current scenario is about the black and white and all those stuff so we are focusing only on legitimate deals with the 100% check payment so there is a clarity of transactions and so then we started with that and today we have projects in about 45 cities so the projects which we market so if you link our activity with this development then probably these are the area where we are working hard to identify the right spot maybe a land and maybe a good developer maybe combination of all and then we can create a product for the consumer I think that's where we connect with this development so our idea is to provide legitimate products which will you know help customer to create wealth over next one or two decades so that's where we are coming from For in this area? Okay. So, yeah. Just to give you a couple of names like Surat, we have a tie-up with two developers for South Gujarat as of now. One is the Agam, which is a Puja basic, the Puja group and the another is a Sai developers they have two projects as of now and one is in Navsari which is a state of the art project that it's designed by Apurva Amin which is he is one of the leading architects in it's a small project but very high value projects and we have identified this area called Bivadi which we have seen in our presentation also So there we are doing about 150 crore project, which is a residential project. And it's a Berry developer. It's a joint venture with the Bhaskar Group, which is a Divya Bhaskar Group. So they are there in this field, and with the Bhaskar Group, we are closely working with them on the new this DMIC patch, because they have identified and they have acquired so many land parcels in MP and Rajasthan, because they belongs to that particular area. So because of their local strength, they are able to acquire, because to acquire land in MP is a big challenge. So they have already acquired land there, so we are in talk with them to figure out a couple of more projects in that particular patch. In Bangalore, we have a tie-up with one developer. His background is he is a electronic engineer, and he worked for Cisco for 25 years, and he shifted his base to India, and because of all these opportunities are there going forward. So there are so this is one of the largest development, but there are so many small corridors are also going to develop. The one of them is the Nandi corridor, which is Bangalore-Mysore highway. So there also the similar story, but at a lower scale. So we have one project there, and there also the idea is to identify those growth area quite early and to work with the like-minded people and the professional people. So so jointly we have identified that particular area, and we have sold a lot of land parcel there to our clients. It depends on the project size, but we are doing one project in Sachin, which is close to the railway station. So Sachin again is a part of this total integrated development of Gujarat, because we have existing GIDC, then the apparel park, SEZ, all of that is there. So there the ticket size is about 5.5 lakhs. So that is a basic unit of about 1 BHK, and 2 BHK is about 7.5 lakhs. It's a very affordable quality product. And but our objective is to work very close to the affordable range. And if we talk about that, is again a different subject. It's required another 40 minutes to make a break. But if you look at the affordable range of each and every city is different. So probably for Surat, maybe the 15 lakhs or 10 lakhs is an affordable housing, but for Bombay it's about 45 to 50 lakhs. For Hyderabad or Bangalore, maybe about 25 to 30 lakhs. And again, area specific. Bhiwadi, our ticket size as of now is about 30 lakhs. 30 lakhs is 2 BHK. Bhiwadi is NCR, and the physical land belongs to Rajasthan. So it's just next to Gurgaon, towards the Jaipur, and very close to the Manesar, the Maruti plant and all. Hero Honda is also there. It's a highly dense industrial area. It's a good spot to invest for future. I think it's a question of priority of the state government. So as of now, the entire energy, the focus is on Dahej and Dholera, because these are the large patches. But the area and the scale is not the only important thing, because this cluster they have identified for the gem and jewelry and other textile and other regions. So, but I think you cannot compare with the Dahej and Dholera, the kind of scale. No, fully though it's very difficult to. They have set first target of 2018, So I think currently the focus is on 2018. So that is the game plan. So Mr. Kant and the other six state government is focusing on to achieve the target of 2018, and then probably step by step. So future growth के अंदर ऐसा है कि आप overall जो major raw material है for the real estate is a land. And land prices का आप अगर movement देखते हो तो that is linked with the industrial growth. तो वो proven है in last many years in many economies. तो जापान का भी अगर आप example देखेंगे तो 40 साल तक market में land का price काफी बढ़ा because of the industrial growth. And जब industrial growth जो stagnant हुआ, there are so many reasons. One of the reason is the aging population. Aging population is one of the major reason for Japan. So, हमारे लिए opportunity है अभी, but Japan की अगर बात करें, तो वहाँ पे the fall in the land price is about 74%. तो जो general लोग हम मानते हैं कि कहीं पे भी land ले लो तो भाव तो उसका तो गिरने वाला नहीं है, वैसा नहीं है. Over a longer period of time, उसका भी भाव गिर सकता है. इंडिया के अंदर वो सिचुएशन कम है बिकॉज वी हैव 1/3 ऑफ लैंड एंड 2/3 ऑफ पॉपुलेशन. सो वो मिक्स है, तो मे बी वो पूरा कैलकुलेशन गलत भी हो सकता है कि यहाँ कोने कोने पे भाव ना भी गिरे अगले 50-60-70 साल तक. बट आपका सवाल जो है उसमें ऐसा है कि जो जहाँ पे इंडस्ट्रियल ग्रोथ विजिबल है वहाँ पे probability to rise land prices is more. So, मतलब आज अपने देखते हैं कि there are certain pockets के वहाँ पे कोई industrial development की कोई हवा ही नहीं है. And land price, if you compare it with the pockets where there is a something is going on. एक आपको एक example देता हूँ कि एक X location है. Will not spot the location. कोई एक X location है. वहाँ पे आपको बताते हैं कि 25 लाख रुपया भींगा आपको मिलेगा. 25 लाख रुपया भींगा माने 25,000 स्क्वायर फीट. 25 लाख तो 100 रुपये चौरस फुट की जगह हुई कच्ची. उसके सामने अगर दहेज के आसपास आपको 40 लाख रुपये एकड़ मिलता है, विच इज 40 लाख, विच इज ऑल्सो 100 रुपीज पर स्क्वायर फीट. तो कॉमन सेंस से ही अपने को पता चल जाएगा कि वो 100 रुपये में यहाँ पे माल लेके क्या ग्रोथ है. हम इसलिए ले रहे हैं क्योंकि वो 2 साल पहले 20 लाख रुपए का भाव था, आजू बाजू वाले ने खरीद लिया, आज 40 हो गया, तो अपने को अभी एंट्री माननी है. बट इफ यू रैशनली कंपेयर द बोथ सिचुएशन तो आपको ऐसा लगेगा कि चलो जहाँ पे इंडस्ट्रियल ग्रोथ है वहां पे उसका भाव ऊपर जाने का चांसेस ज्यादा है. तो वैसा हम लोग काम करते हैं. सो वी ट्राई टू स्पॉट द एक्टिविटीज कि क्या प्लान है, कहाँ पे क्या उसका डीएम डेवलपमेंट प्लान बना है, देन टीपी बना है, कौन सी कंपनीज ने वहाँ पे लैंड ले रखा है, किसनी कंपनी ने चालू किया है काम, कहाँ पे एम्प्लॉयमेंट बढ़ रहा है. तो ये पूरा लिंक है. तो ये गवर्नमेंट भी जो एस्टिमेट बनाती है कि 2020 में इतना पॉपुलेशन एम्प्लॉयमेंट होगा, 2030 में इतना एम्प्लॉयमेंट होगा, तो उसका कैलकुलेशन का मेथोडोलॉजी है कि ये पर्टिकुलर इंडस्ट्री आएगा, एक एक्स सेक्टर आएगा, वाई सेक्टर आएगा, जेड सेक्टर आएगा, तो वो सेक्टर का प्रोडक्टिविटी वो लोग मेजर करते हैं कि इसमें से कितना प्रोडक्टिविटी आएगा. वो प्रोडक्टिविटी के हिसाब से एम्प्लॉयमेंट आता है, वो एम्प्लॉयमेंट के हिसाब से हाउसिंग डिमांड क्रिएट होता है. तो वो पूरा इंटीग्रेटेड अप्रोच रहता है एंड बेस्ड ऑन दैट द लैंड प्राइसेस विल गो अप डाउन वैसा. तो मोटा मोटी अपने को एक डायरेक्शन यहाँ से मिलता है कि कौन सी डायरेक्शन में अपने को जाना है. मतलब लोकली आप खुद भी ये रिसर्च कर सकते हो कि कहाँ पे डेवलपमेंट हो रहा है, कहाँ पे एम्प्लॉयमेंट, कहाँ पे नया जॉब अपॉर्चुनिटी क्रिएट हो रहा है, वहां पे लैंड ले सकते हो. वहाँ पे आप काम कर सकते हो, तो वहाँ पे डेफिनेटली। बट यहाँ पे अपने को पता है कि यहाँ पे खेती बाड़ी के अलावा कुछ काम ही नहीं होने वाला है अगला 10-20 साल, कोई हवा है ही नहीं, तो वहाँ पे लैंड का इतना पैसा चुकाने का कोई फायदा नहीं है रिलेटिवली। See, there are two methodology of doing business. One is you take what is available, and second is you take what you want. तो हमारा थोड़ा पहले से वैसा है कि अपने को जो चाहिए उस पर थोड़ा फोकस ज्यादा करते हैं। I think that is meaningful. And जब rationally भी सोचते हो तो हमें डिफिकल्टी है, बट अल्टीमेटली कस्टमर को फायदा है, और जो चीज कस्टमर को फायदा है वो लॉन्ग टर्म हमको फायदा करा के जाएगी। नहीं, इंडिविजुअली नहीं करेंगे। हाँ हाँ, नहीं हो सकता है, विल मीट एंड करेंगे। नाउ दिस इज टाइम टू हियर सम फ्यू वर्ड्स फ्रॉम रोहित भाई। रोहित भाई इज ऑलरेडी देयर एंड थैंक यू वेरी मच
जिग्नेश भाई देसाई फॉर थ्रोइंग लाइट एंड डिस्कस्ड इन डिटेल how the future of India and Gujarat in particular and its cities will look like, and hence the various opportunities for investment. And in addition to that, the vast opportunities available because of this DMIC, which is a golden opportunity for Gujarat for investment. Now I request President Rohit Bhai Mehta to speak few words.
जिग्नेश भाई, नीरज भाई, मैं चंबरना, मेरा मित्रों, आई थिंक दिस वॉज अ फैंटास्टिक सेशन वेयर जिग्नेश भाई गेव सम वेरी गुड एंड वेरी इम्पोर्टेंट इन्फॉर्मेशन अबाउट द डेवलपमेंट्स दैट आर एक्सपेक्टेड इन दिस रीजन। एनजे बात करिए तो आई मीन आई हैव सीन देम ग्रो एंड दे हैव ग्रोन बिग एंड दैट इज द रीजन बिहाइंड इट इज दे हैव बीन स्मार्ट ऑल अलोंग एंड व्हेन यू आर स्मार्ट यू मेक स्मार्ट इन्वेस्टमेंट एंड यू टेक स्मार्ट डिसीजंस एंड देन योर मनी ऑल्सो ग्रोज इन अ वेरी स्मार्ट वे। सो दैट इज द ट्रिक that they have followed, that is the system that they have followed, and I am very happy that they are ready to share their secret and they are ready to help people grow. As members of the chamber, we are all business people, and we look forward to growth, we look forward to opportunities, and it is in place that we think of growth and we think of development and we think of how to prosper. These type of seminars where friends like Jignesh Bhai, Neeraj Bhai, they give us very valuable information and spot information. They can go a long way in helping us to prosper, because we are not focused on many aspects. I mean, I basically feel that everybody has to stick to their core competence. And if you are a good businessman, you need to do your business and leave your money for somebody else to grow. And that is what I think they are doing in a very smart way. They are helping you to identify opportunities out of your spare money, out of your money that is not your business money. And I think these type of opportunities go a long way in bringing the pink flavor to your balance sheet. So it's a very welcome session, and Neeraj bhai and Jignesh bhai, I think every year we have one session with you, and it's very welcome. And thanks to Suresh bhai, he is always very keen to bring us all to this facility and give us some good inputs. I am not in a stage to welcome you here because we are welcome. But I would express, like to express my gratitude to you. You have been so kind to guide us, and you have been kind to help our members understand the opportunities, especially when real estate is a very tricky subject. And a lot of people tend to lose a lot of money in real estate. And believe me, I'm one of them. Nevertheless, this is where smart people like you and very transparent people like you, very learned people like you, who have done their homework well, can really be very, very helpful. I'm sure all my friends here, they must have gained a lot from the inputs that you have given. And I would welcome more such initiatives where you can definitely bring or throw some light on new areas of, or new avenues of opportunities. And I think we can also have similar seminars in the chamber where you are our guest speakers, and we can take it forward in a big way. So, my dear friends, I think it was a very good session, and as I said, I cannot welcome you here, but on behalf of all my friends from the chamber, I would like to express my gratitude to you for being so kind enough and guiding us in this very important subject of investment and opportunities in real estate. Thank you.
Now I request President of SGCCI, Sri Rohit Bhai Mehta, to welcome and present a bouquet and memento to Sri Jignesh Bhai Desai. I also request to present a bouquet and a memento to Mr. Neeraj Bhai Choksi. We also like to utilize this opportunity to welcome and present a book to the fathers of the founders of NJ India Invest. Sri Ramesh Bhai Desai, please. Ramesh Bhai Desai is president of Navsari Chamber of Commerce and Industry. I request Dilip Bhai Chashmawala, our past president, to present a book to Ramesh Bhai Desai. We have also with us Sri Ravindra Bhai Choksi, father of Neeraj Bhai Choksi, will like to present them with a book. And I request our past president, Mr. Arvind Bhai Kapadia, to please come and present them. Now I request our Honorary Secretary, Sri Dhiran Bhai Tarnari, to propose a vote of thanks.
President Rohit Mehta, our
આપણે એમને ગેસ તો નહીં કહી શકીએ, પણ આપણે જેમના ગેસ છીએ એવા જિગ્નેશભાઈ અને નીરજભાઈ, ચેમ્બરના સેમિનાર ઇન્ચાર્જ સિદ્ધાર્થ અને આજના કાર્યક્રમના કોઓર્ડિનેટર સુરેશભાઈ, ખાસ કરીને આખો પ્રોગ્રામ એનજે જિગ્નેશભાઈ અને નીરજભાઈ તરફથી સ્પોન્સર કરવામાં આવ્યો છે એના બદલ તો આપણે એમનો જેટલો આભાર માનીએ એટલો ઓછો છે, પણ પ્રેઝન્ટેશન જોયા પછી મને એવું લાગે છે કે કદાચ આ પ્રેઝન્ટેશનમાં જે ડીએમઆઈસીનું આપે જે વિગતવાર જે માહિતી આપી મેં તો કદાચ પહેલી વાર આટલી જોઈ છે, અને ડોલેરા મેં નામ સાંભળ્યું છે પણ ડોલેરામાં આટલી બધી ઓપોર્ચ્યુનિટી હોય એવું કદાચ મેં પણ પહેલી વખત સાંભળ્યું છે, અને આપ અહીંયા જે બેઠા છે એ લોકોએ મને એવું લાગે છે કે ડોલેરા વિશે આટલી બધી ડિટેલમાં ચર્ચા, એટલે મને એવું લાગે છે કે જે રીતનું રિસર્ચ ડિપાર્ટમેન્ટ આ એનજીઓનું કામ કરી રહ્યું છે અને જે માહિતી એ લોકો જે લાવે છે અને માહિતી આપણી સુધી આપણા સુધી જે પહોંચાડે છે એના માટે એમનો જેટલો આભાર માનીએ એટલો ઓછો છે. કદાચ હું શબ્દોથી એમ કહું કે વી આર વેરી મચ થેન્કફુલ, પણ એ કદાચ બહુ ઓછું લાગે એવું મને પોતાને લાગે છે કે જે માહિતી આપે જિગ્નેશભાઈ આપી અને જે એના પરથી બહુ સ્પષ્ટ ખાલી એક આટલું 30-40 મિનિટના પ્રેઝન્ટેશન પરથી જ આપણને ખ્યાલ આવી જાય છે કે એનજે શું ચીજ છે, કે કેટલી બધી ઝીણામાં ઝીણી માહિતી, કેટલી બધી માઇનોર થિંગ છે. કોઈ એક એવું નહીં કે ભાઈ કોઈ જગ્યાએ જે રીતે આપણે મ્યુચ્યુઅલ ફંડ કે એમાં ઇન્વેસ્ટ કરતા હોય, આપણે કોઈ સ્ક્રીપની અંદર તો કેટલું બધું રિસર્ચ કરતા હોય, એવું રિયલ એસ્ટેટમાં એ લોકો આવી રહ્યા છે તો રિયલ એસ્ટેટની એક એક નાનામાં નાની માહિતી એમની પાસે છે. અને કદાચ આજ આવું જ રિસર્ચ કદાચ એન્જિનને આટલા ઓછા વર્ષોમાં આટલું ઉપર સુધી લઈ આવ્યા હોય એવું મને લાગે છે. ફરી પાછો હું નીરજભાઈ જિગ્નેશભાઈનો ખૂબ ખૂબ આભાર માનું છું ચેમ્બર તરફથી, ચેમ્બરના તમામ જે સભ્યો અહીંયા હાજર છે એમનો પણ હું ખાસ આભાર માનું છું, ખાસ આભાર હું સુરેશભાઈનો માનવા માંગુ છું કે એમણે આજે કોઓર્ડિનેટ કરી આખી મીટિંગ, એમનો ખૂબ ખૂબ આભાર. ફરી પાછો આપનો આભાર માનીને પણ થેન્ક યુ. ચેમ્બરમાં પણ આપણે આવું એક કઈક પ્રોગ્રામ ગોઠવીશું, એ ગોઠવી આપણે એક મોટા લેવલ પર, કારણ કે આવું પ્રેઝન્ટેશન કદાચ મેં તો નથી જ જોયું ને અહીંયા બધા હાજર બેઠા છે લોકો કહે છે કે કોઈ આવું પ્રેઝન્ટેશન જોયું નથી. ઓકે, થેન્ક યુ વેરી મચ.
ફ્રેન્ડ્સ, એનજે તરફથી ચેમ્બર ઓફ કોમર્સના અમે આભારી છીએ. ચેમ્બર ઇઝ ઓલવેઝ વેરી કાઇન્ડ, ધ લીડરશીપ ઇન ચેમ્બર ઇઝ વેરી ફોર્થકમિંગ, પર્ટિક્યુલરલી સાઉથ ગુજરાત ચેમ્બર ઓફ કોમર્સ ઇઝ વેરી વેરી એક્ટિવ અને સુરતના શહેરને ખૂબ સારું નામ આપ્યું છે. અને પર્ટિક્યુલરલી એનજે સાથે ચેમ્બરના જે સંબંધો છે તે ભવિષ્યમાં અને પ્રેઝન્ટમાં વધી રહ્યા છે, અને વી આર વેરી ફોર્ચ્યુનેટ દેટ વી ગોટ ધીસ ઓપોર્ચ્યુનિટી ટુ પ્રેઝન્ટ અવર થોટ્સ ઓન રિયલ એસ્ટેટ. થોડું એનજેના વિઝન વિશે હું 2 મિનિટ કહીશ. અમારું વિઝન જે છે દેટ ઇઝ ટુવર્ડ્સ લોંગ ટર્મ વેલ્થ ક્રિએશન ઓફ કસ્ટમર્સ. એટલે જે કોઈ પણ પ્રોડક્ટ્સ કે ઇન્વેસ્ટમેન્ટ એવન્યુઝમાં અમે કામ કરી રહ્યા છીએ તો એમાં અમારો ચોક્કસપણે આ જે એક બેઝિક વેલ્યુ સિસ્ટમ છે કે જે અમારું વિઝન છે કે વી આર વર્કિંગ ટુવર્ડ્સ લોંગ ટર્મ વેલ્થ ક્રિએશન. શોર્ટ ટર્મની કોઈ વસ્તુઓમાં અમને ઇન્ટરેસ્ટ નથી, યુનિડાયરેક્શનલ ફોકસ છે. પ્રોડક્ટ કોઈ પણ હોય પણ જે અલ્ટિમેટલી કસ્ટમરને ફાયદો થાય એવા કાર્યો કરવાનો અમે પ્રયત્ન કરીએ છીએ અને એવી સેવા આપવાનો અમે પ્રયત્ન કરીએ છીએ. અને આઈ થિંક વી આર અગેન થેન્કફુલ ટુ યુ જિગ્નેશભાઈ, જે પ્રેઝન્ટેશન આપ્યું તો રિયલ એસ્ટેટ સેક્ટરમાં વી આર ટ્રાઇંગ કે અમે અમારું રિસર્ચ વધારે ને વધારે પાવરફુલ કરીએ અને વી વિલ ટ્રાય ટુ ક્રિએટ ઓપોર્ચ્યુનિટીઝ ઇવન ઇન રિયલ એસ્ટેટ કે એકદમ ઇઝીલી ટ્રાન્ઝેક્ટ કરી શકો, કારણ કે આજે મોટામાં મોટું રિસ્ક કદાચ ટ્રાન્ઝેક્શનનું છે એમાં, તો એમાં અમે અમારા ચોક્કસ પ્રયત્નો કરશું. છેલ્લી એક લાસ્ટ એક મારી ફેવરેટ સેઇંગ છે જે આપણે સર બેન્જામિન ગ્રેહામ જે ઇન્વેસ્ટમેન્ટના ગુરુ કહેવાય એમને કહી છે કે પર્ટિક્યુલરલી વેલ્થ ક્રિએશનના માટે છે કે ઇટ ઇઝ ધ પેશન્સ દેટ ગેટ્સ ટેસ્ટેડ પેશન્સની પરીક્ષા છે એન્ડ ઇટ ઇઝ ધ કન્વિક્શન દેટ ગેટ્સ રિવોર્ડેડ સો વી વર્ક વિથ પેશન્સ એન્ડ કન્વિક્શન થેન્ક યુ We would like to felicitate Rohit bhai. Secretary sir. Dhiren bhai. Please join us for dinner. Badda dinner laine jojo.